we're beholden to your generous hospitality today. Permit us to repay in kind in another time." They left together. Soon the sun rose high in the sky, but Tripitaka was still in a stupor, unable to discern which way was north, south, east, or west. In that half-dead condition, he suddenly saw an old man approaching, holding a staff in his hands. Walking up to Tripitaka, the man waved his hands and all the ropes snapped. He then blew on Tripitaka, and the monk began to revive. "Falling on the ground," he said, "I thank the aged father for saving the life of this poor monk. Get up," the old man said, returning his salute. "Have you lost anything?" "The followers of your poor monk," said Tripitaka, "have been eaten by the monsters. I have no idea where my horse is or my luggage." "Isn't that your horse over there with the two bundles?" asked the old man, pointing with his staff. Tripitaka turned around and discovered that his belongings had indeed remained untouched. Somewhat relieved, he asked the old man, "Aged father, what is this place? How do you happen to be here?" "It is called the Double Fork Ridge, a place infested with tigers and wolves." "How did you manage to get here?" "At the first crow of the cock," said Tripitaka. "Your poor monk left the district of Huzhou. Little did I realize that we had risen too early, and we lost our way tramping through fog and dew. We came upon this monster king so exceedingly ferocious that he captured me and my two followers. There was also a swarthy fellow called the Bear Mountain Lord, and a husky fellow called the Steer Hermit. They arrived and addressed the monster king as General Ying. All three of them devoured my two followers and retired only at dawn. I have no idea where I accrued the fortune and merit that caused the aged father to rescue me here." "That Steer Hermit," said the old man, "is a wild bull spirit. The Mountain Lord, a bear spirit. And General Ying, a tiger spirit. The various ogres are all demons of mountains and trees, spirits of strange beasts and wolves. Because of the primal purity of your nature, they cannot devour you. Follow me now, and I shall lead you on your way." Tripitaka could not be more thankful. Fastening the bundles on the saddle and leading his horse, he followed the old man out of the pit and walked toward the main road. He tied the horse to the bushes beside the path and turned to thank the aged father. At that moment, a gentle breeze swept by, and the old man rose into the air and left, riding on a white crane with a crimson head. As the wind subsided, a slip of paper fluttered down, with four lines of verse written on it. "I am the planet Venus from the west, who came to save you by special request. Some pupils divine will come to your aid. Blame not the scriptures for hardships ahead." When Tripitaka read this, he bowed toward the sky saying, "I thank the gold star for seeing me through this ordeal." After that, he led his horse off again on his lonely and melancholy journey. "On this ridge, truly you have cold and suffing the wind of the rainforest, purling and gurgling the water of the brooklets, fragrant and musky wildflowers in bloom, in clutters and clumps, rough rocks piled high, chattering and clattering the apes and the deer, in rank and file, the musk and the fallow deer, chirping and cooing, birds frequently call. Silent and still, not one man is in sight. That master shivers and quivers to his anxious mind. This dear horse, scared and nervous, can barely raise his legs. Ready to abandon his body and sacrifice his life, Tripitaka started up that rugged mountain. He journeyed for half a day, but not a single human being or dwelling was in sight. He was gnawed by hunger and disheartened by the rough road. In that desperate moment, he saw two fierce tigers growling in front of him and several huge snakes circling behind him. Vicious creatures appeared on his left and strange beasts on his right. As he was all by himself, Tripitaka had little alternative but to submit himself to the will of heaven. As if to complete his helplessness, his horse's back was sagging and its legs were buckling. It went to its knees and soon lay prostrate on the ground. He could budge it neither by beating nor by tugging. With hardly an inch of space to stand on, our master of the law was in the depths of despair, thinking that certain death would be his fate. We can tell you, however, that though he was in danger, help was on its way. For just as he thought he was about to expire, the vicious creatures began to scatter and the monstrous beasts fled. The fierce tigers vanished and the huge snakes disappeared. When Tripitaka looked further ahead, he saw a man coming over the mountain slope with a steel trident in his hands and bow and arrows at his waist. He was indeed a valiant figure. Look at him. He had on his head a cap of leopard skin, spotted and artemisia white. He wore on his body a robe of lamb's wool with dark silk brocade. Around his waist was tied a lion king belt. And on his feet he wore tall boots of suede. His eyes would bulge like those of someone hung. His beard curled wildly like a fierce god's. A bow and poisoned arrows hung on him. He held a huge trident of finest steel. His voice like thunder appalled mountain cats. And wild pheasants quaked at his truculence. When Tripitaka saw him draw near, he knelt at the side of the path and called out, his hands clasped in front of him. Great King, save me! Great King, save me! The fellow came up to Tripitaka and put down his trident. Raising up the monk with his hands, he said, don't be afraid, elder, for I'm not a wicked man. I'm a hunter living in this mountain. My surname is Leo, and my given name is Baoqin. I also go by the nickname of Senior Guardian of the Mountain. I came here to find some animals to eat, not expecting to run into you. I hope I didn't scare you. Your poor monk, said Tripitaka, is a cleric who has been sent by His Majesty the Tang Emperor to seek scriptures from Buddha in the Western Heaven. When I arrived here a few moments ago, I was surrounded by tigers, wolves, and snakes so that I could not proceed. But when the creatures saw you coming, they all scattered, and you have thus saved my life. Many thanks. Many thanks. Since I live here and my livelihood depends on killing a few tigers and wolves, said Baoqin, or catching a few snakes and reptiles, I usually frighten the wild beasts away. If you have come from the Tang Empire, you are actually a native here, for this is still Tang territory, and I am a Tang subject. You and I both live off the land belonging to the Emperor, so that we are in truth citizens of the same nation. Don't be afraid. Follow me. You may rest your horse at my place, and I shall see you off in the morning. Tripitaka was filled with delight when he heard these words, and he led his horse to follow the hunter. They passed the slope and again heard the howling of the wind. Sit here, elder, said Baoqin, and don't move. The sound of that wind tells me that a mountain cat is approaching. I'll take him home so that I can make a meal of him for you. When Tripitaka heard this, his heart hammered and his gall quivered and he became rooted to the ground. Grasping his trident, that guardian strode forward and came face to face with a great striped tiger. Seeing Baoqin, he turned and fled. Like a crack of thunder, the guardian bellowed, cursed beast! Where will you flee? When the tiger saw him pressing near, he turned with flailing claws to spring at him, only to be met by the guardian with uplifted trident. Tripitaka was so terrified that he lay paralyzed on the grass. Since leaving his mother's belly, when had he ever witnessed such violent and dangerous goings-on? The guardian went after that tiger to the foot of the slope, and it was a magnificent battle between man and beast. You see, raging resentment and churning whirlwind. In raging resentment, the potent guardian's hair pushed up his cap. Like churning whirlwind, the striped prince belched dust, displaying his might. This one bared its teeth and wielded its paws. That one stepped sideways, yet turning to fight. The trident reached skyward, reflecting the sun. The striped tail stirred up both fog and cloud. This one stabbed madly at the breast of his foe. That one, facing him, would swallow him whole. Stay away and you may live out your years. Join the fray and you'll meet Yuma, the king. You hear the roar of the striped prince and the harsh cries of the guardian. The roar of the striped prince shook mountains and streams to frighten birds and beasts. The harsh cries of the guardian unlocked the heavens to make the stars appear. The gold eyeballs of this one protruded, and wrath burst from the bold heart of that one. Lovable was Leo, the mountain guardian. Praiseworthy was this king of the wild beasts. So tiger and man fought, each craving life a little slower, and one forfeits his soul. The two of them fought for about an hour, and as the paws of the tiger began to slow and his torso to slacken, he was downed by the guardian's trident, stabbing him through the chest. A pitiful sight it was. The points of the trident pierced the heart, and at once the ground was covered with blood. The guardian then dragged the beast by the ear up the road. What a man! He hardly panted, nor did his face change color. He said to Tripitaka, "We're lucky. We're lucky. This mountain cat should be sufficient for a day's food for the elder." Applauding him unceasingly, Tripitaka said, "The guardian is truly a mountain god. What ability do I have?" said Baoqin, "that I merit such a claim. This is really the good fortune of the father. Let's go. I'd like to skin him quickly so that I can cook some of his meat to entertain you." He held the trident in one hand and dragged the tiger with the other, leading the way while Tripitaka followed him with his horse. They walked together past the slope and all at once came upon a mountain village, in front of which were old trees soaring skyward, roads filled with wild creepers. In countless canyons the wind was cool,